I'm Duncan Choyan, the Media Manager of Australian Plays, and we're talking to the creative team behind the Disability Slapstick Plan today at the National Play Festival. So if you'd like to go around and just introduce yourselves.
Hello, I am Jonathan Haynes, Joint Artistic Director of Ridiculousness, and one of the team, the collaborative team behind the Disability Slapstick Plan.
David Woods.
Eve Sifis.
Trevor Dunn.
Bethy Bobbitt.
Jessica Kapuscinski-Evans.
So tell me about the title of the piece and what that references.
Disability Slapstick Plan is kind of a parody. A lot of agencies, and perhaps the theatre that you work for, would have a disability action plan, and if your theatre doesn't have a disability action plan, they should. But a disability slapstick plan is perhaps a parody and a send-up of what a disability action plan might be.
And it's also a play on words, because the initials DSP is what many people with disability survive on, the disability support pension.
But for those playing at home who don't know what a disability action plan is, it's a very sort of dry, boring document that basically says how the organisation is going to be inclusive of people with disabilities, which includes things like making physical premises without steps and things, but it also often includes things like policies and procedures and non-discrimination. It sort of encompasses quite a lot of stuff, and it's theoretically meant to improve the total number of people with disabilities within a given organisation. I've done one actually, and it's horrendous. It's like pulling your teeth trying to write one of these things, but at the same time, then. But I think I understand that, so again, this is from the stage of the process that I wasn't there, but I understand that, like, the idea was to parody the whole process of sort of governments and bureaucrats sort of having this document so that it looks like they're being inclusive, but then it kind of allows them to actually not do anything.
Yeah, we've ticked a box somewhere that
yeah.
says something. Yeah. And it's a comedy, we would say?
Oh, well, look, it's no longer a disability slapstick plan. So the title is a sort of carryover from where the project was, but not where it is now.
Fantastic.
So it's moved on a pace from that bureaucratic send-up. It's moved into a new field of what is the politics of representation in theatre, which has got something to do with disability, but not exclusively. And so a lot of time we're talking French. Because who has the right to be a French person?
Yeah.
Do you have the right to be a French person and
Certainly
speak
not.
French? Or do I, if I put on a French accent, is that legitimate? Is that honest? Wouldn't a French person be offended by me putting on a fake French
yeah.
accent? And so look, Peter Sellers in the Pink Panther movies, he had his French accent, but is that offensive to French people? Do they really want someone to be talking French in that way? So it's those kind of politics. Who has the right to represent? And so we sort of have our own take on it from the disability community, and that's kind of what the work is about now, but at the moment it's still evolving, so it might even have another life beyond this particular form. So that's where it is at the moment.
Excellent. And so tell us about the play festival process so far. What have you been doing and up to this?
We've been, just this year, meeting together, getting it into a script form. And that's not an easy task when you have so much material and it's changed so many times. But somehow it's managed to have been done by mainly the work of these two gentlemen. But it's it's now becoming, I think, a quite an amazing script. It's like, it drags you in to pay attention to all of the disability issues that you've never thought about. You don't even think about things like that, you know. All of us have such differing disability issues. And I learned something yesterday, even when I had said, referred to Jess in some way that she found offensive. And that's the last thing I would ever do. I'm not that kind of person. And yet you have to know what to say and what you shouldn't say, what offends. And like I said, I miss what my arthritis has done to me. I can't run up the stairs and look in shops and go and see dogs and things. Hello? Think about that. That's offensive to some people.
It's broad territory for sure.
Mm. So there's a lot to learn still in every step of the way.
The ridiculousness process, as I understand it, is that it's sort of part fictional, traditional script writing and part sort of verbatim stuff where, you know, the exact words that were spoken in a, you know, non-fictional conversation are then somehow morphed into the script. So some of it is sort of, you know, quite traditional, almost bordering on melodrama, kind of clowny stuff, and then some of it is kind of, you know, very thinly disguised. I'm just Jess being Jess on stage, and I'm saying these words that I said, you know, that I don't even remember saying 2 years ago, but somehow they end up in the script.
One of the things that I find really fascinating in the whole process is that whenever I've been involved in writing, which I have been many times, I always think it's important for you to keep your eye on the theme of the play, on what you're trying to say in the play, and keep going back to that. Don't let some little funny moment take you into that and you add that, you know, which of course is what we do in this process. And I'm finding now that it can still work if you're a good chooser.
and I have to say that our own personal emotions and standpoints and points of friction have come out in the script of the play, and some of them are verbatim. So a lot of it has. A lot of it is reflective of our inner beings and of what makes us tick. And I think that's a really important aspect to be part of this play.
Mm. And just lastly, what, and this is for everyone really, what excites you the most about getting to share it, you know, this iteration of it with an audience?
Being recognised again.
Education, and not my tip. To help the public, the general public, to understand better about disability and disability actors. And you think, wow, we're going to do some good things, you know, hopefully.
Yeah.
Of course, that as well.
I think I have a bit of a love-hate relationship with the mainstream in all aspects of culture. But I think, for me, what's really encouraging is that a work like this is part of a national festival.
Precisely.
Mm, exactly.
Because from what I understand about this particular festival, there hasn't really been a disability presence here.
No, I don't think there has been.
And so I feel very special to be, you know, one of the first people.
It's so important because disability affects 20% of our population in some way, shape or form, and yet it's completely absent from any sort of representation.
I think
it's time to change that.
Yeah, and like you said, it's actually sometimes often, it's not even thought about, it's not even considered. You know. Or we've ticked a document somewhere and that's
your plan.
Put it out of mind. Yeah, fantastic. Well, thanks so much for talking to us and good luck with the reading
Thank you.
And going forward. Thank you. very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.